Hey there! You are about to be part of the most exciting video about amniotic fluid that has ever been created.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1!
And make sure you're watching at the end because I am busting out some water balloons. And we're going to talk all about that mysterious event of pregnancy known as water breaking.
I think my water just broke.
Oh my God. Cassie!
Hey, if we haven't met before, my name is Alice Turner. I have attended over 300 births as a doula and I've taught even more families. On this channel, I love creating videos that help you prepare for birth by bringing you information that you can actually use. So if that sounds good to you and you like these topics, hit that subscribe buttons for more videos like this. Now, about amniotic fluid, let's start with a quick anatomy lesson. Our baby lives in a fluid-filled sac inside of our uterus. The fluid is called amniotic fluid. The sac, amniotic sac. Now this fluid, it's regulated by the placenta, but the baby also contributes to the fluid level through their urine. Now, fluid is vitally important to the health, the growth of your baby. It's like the baby is inside a water balloon, and it helps the baby from being injured. It protects baby. It helps the cord from being compressed. Because this fluid level is so important, it's actually measured during ultrasounds. So during the ultrasound procedure, the sonographer is going to look for dark pockets of fluid, measure those, add them up, and they come to a measurement called the AFI, or the amniotic fluid index. Now the AFI, it changes from early pregnancy through late pregnancy, and I'm gonna need some more props to discuss. Now that we have our amniotic fluid, let's measure out the different levels at the different times are different weeks of pregnancy. So at 12 weeks, our amniotic fluid is just about 60 milliliters. Right here, this is our 12 week. Now, let's do at 16 weeks. 16 weeks, that's about 3/4 of a cup. So we've gone from 12 weeks to 16 weeks, where we have the most amniotic fluid. That's right around 34 weeks. And we're looking at about 3.5 cups for 34 weeks, 800 milliliters. 3.5 cups, which is about 800 milliliters, okay? So quite a difference. At 40 weeks, actually between 34 weeks and 40, let's use this cup for 40, our fluid goes down a bit towards the end of your pregnancy, from 34 weeks down to 40 weeks. So we can see that it has gone down some. So again, we've got 12 weeks, 16, 34, that's where we have our most on average, and then our 40 weeks. Two ways that you have control over your fluid level is hydration, staying really hydrated, and rest. So if you are going in for an ultrasound, I would like you to focus on your hydration and rest. It can really make an impact in the amniotic fluid levels. So let's say you're going in for an ultrasound on a Wednesday. How about focus on fluid and rest the Saturday before and all the way leading up, so that when you have that ultrasound measurement, you have a nice, healthy fluid level. There are two problems that can happen with our amniotic fluid. One is too little fluid, which is oligohydraminos, and that is when you have less than 500 milliliters in your second trimester. Or if you have too much, which is oligohydraminos, and that is when you have around 2,000 milliliters. Now that we are well versed on the amniotic fluid, it is time to break some water.
I'm fine. No way, she peed. Her water broke.
Hey guys, here in the bathroom where we are going to show different types of water breaking. Now, the first one I want to talk about is spontaneous rupture of membranes, where we are going to have a big contraction and enough pressure is going to be inside that we're going to get a significant hole in our amniotic sac. That's what this water balloon is representing. So our amniotic sac gets a hole and we have what is considered a big gush come out. So that's the first. Now, spontaneous rupture of membranes actually only happens at the beginning of labor, like at the start of labor, for about 10% of people. Most people experience spontaneous rupture of membranes if their water isn't broken by their care provider sometime in labor, when labor really starts going. So that's spontaneous rupture of membranes. So let's look at, I'm going to use a pen and we're going to put a little pressure on this water balloon when we break the water, and let's see what that gush looks like. Now, this is about the same quantity of water that we have around 36 to 40 weeks. Okay, let's break it. So here we are with our sac. I'm going to put a little bit of pressure on it, and then we have... So if we're going to show an artificial rupture of membranes, that's when we're going to use the amnihook. So the amnihook has a little tiny piece on it. You can just see it. It's like a little piece of plastic. The artificial rupture of membranes is your care provider is going to thread the amnihook up through the vagina and the cervix, and then is going to just snag the bag, the amniotic sac, with that little hook. And we've got a rupture. So the next type of leak is not quite as dramatic, but happens and is a little confusing when it happens if you're experiencing. And that's when you have a high leak. So that is where it's suspected that somewhere up in the top of your amniotic sac, you have a small hole. So when you have a contraction, some fluid comes out, but it doesn't come out in that big gush. So what I'm gonna do is take my pen very carefully and do a small hole over here. Just gonna do a little small hole without the pressure. And what you'll see, can you see that water coming out? So the fluid, it leaks. Sometimes with a high leak, it trickles. So it's coming out, but it's not coming out in a huge amount. And the other thing to note is that your baby's head might be sitting really close onto your cervix. And if that's the case, then as the water comes out here, the baby's head might cork some of the fluid, and so that the fluid can kind of be on and off in spurts and not that huge gush that we saw with the other example. So this last example I want to show is kind of another interesting situation, and that's when you have a leak of what's called a forebag. So technically, the bag is made up of two membranes. So you can see this here. I have a blue balloon. I have an orange balloon. The blue is inside the orange. So the membranes are actually two layer. And occasionally, there can be fluid that is trapped in between the two layers, or that only one layer breaks with maybe a high leak. And so what this looks like in labor is that you seem to have a gush or a slow leak, and then you stop having much leaking. And when your provider checks, they can feel that the bag is still intact, even though you might have had a gush. So what I'm going to do is make a hole in just one layer in this outside layer, and let's see what happens. So I'm just making a hole in this outside membrane. I put some water in just the orange. So can you guys see that? I put some water in the orange layer, but most of the water is in the blue layer. So we've got a leak here and we're having contractions and it's leaking. You can see the water is leaking. But what will happen is that after some time, after all the water kind of leaks out from that membrane, yep, here we go. All the water has leaked out and, oh, a little bit more came when we had another contraction, but it has leaked out and we have an intact bag, what seems like an intact bag, but clearly if you experienced this, if you were the one to experience this in labor and you had all of that water collect in a pad or in your underwear, you would know that something came out, but it feels a little bit mysterious when there's still a membrane. So a lot of times providers will call that a forebag. And then later on, they will maybe come in and want to or suggest to break the water again. And sometimes it might take a couple of pulls to try to get that just right. But, and then, or we can wait for another spontaneous rupture.